Mrs. Adorda, but I met her through her daughter, Brenda Mohammed, and we're going to continue our conversation. And I just want to make you aware that the book, my book, is completed, The Book Without a Name. You read it and you name it. And at some point, Brenda will give you some inspiration that she felt because she completed the book. So right now, we want to introduce Brenda, part two.
Yeah, thank you, Rose. Thank you for having me once again. Yes, I did complete reading your book on my trip to Ghana. I took a couple of books with me, and one of them was your book.
Thank you.
And as a matter of fact, I left the book there with a young woman in Ghana, a young woman who's 27 years old, and I felt that she could get a lot. I said, this was a gift to me. But I'm pretty sure Rose would not mind me giving it to you. And when you finish reading it, please give it to another sister or give it to someone because there's so much in there that will enlighten you and give you an understanding of a lot of things that are going on in your life. Because we all live, many of us live the same life.
The same.
We know we just have different names, but we're having a lot of the same experiences mm-hmm. as spiritual beings here.
Mm-hmm.
So please, it's an excellent read. And anyone who has the book, when you finish it, don't just put it on the shelf and let it collect dust. Give it to someone else because they can benefit immensely from Rose's book with no name.
Thank you. Well, a lot of people bought the book for other people as gifts mm-hmm. because they say they find it to be very healing, which that's what I wanted. I didn't write the book, you know, get rich and that's it. I want the message to be conveyed. And so far, over 500 people got the message who bought the book. Mm-hmm. And the book is basically new.
Yeah.
And Barnes & Noble has requested an order. Mm-hmm. So by January 2007, it will be in Barnes & Noble and a lot of other bookstores because this bookman channel through me from the Creator. It's His message. It just came through me.
Right. Well, you know, people have a tendency, in reading the book, Rose, you revealed a lot of personal things about your relationship, your familial relationship, and your relationship with friends as well. And people have a tendency to say, "Ooh, you shouldn't air your dirty laundry." What is dirty laundry? you know what, like I said, many of us have the same experiences, and a part of healing is revealing.
Revealing.
A part of healing is taking some of this out of us, that's stuffed right down in, you know, in our very gut and our very heart, that's causing us to have all this disease in our body, while we have prostate cancer, while we have cancer, while we are constipated. You know, people walking around with a frown on their face because they need to have bowel movement sometimes. And that bowel movement is based on the fact that they got all this pain and
emotional
pain. Stuff backed up in them. So, you know, for those people who are saying, oh, you know, we shouldn't tell this and that, that's a secret. What's the secret? You know, we need to heal as a people.
But this is why this book was so important, because I had to go through that healing process. And I didn't have a problem expressing, and like you say, people say dirty laundry, but my thing is, it's reality, it's truth.
It's not laundry.
It's not dirty, it's reality. But you know what? Most people can't handle the truth.
Mm.
We've been conditioned to accept the lie, the deception and continue to perpetuate it from one generation to the next. So when truth come, it scared the hell out of people. They can't handle it. And to acknowledge it, it means change. People are afraid of change. Because if something is hurting you, and you realize this, now what I'm going to do? And in the seminar, I had people to hold both hands out. And I say, imagine I have this hot piece of iron, and I'm going to drop it in your hand. Everybody went like this. I say, so why are you still carrying pain from your childhood? Because now you can let it go. And there's plenty of help out there. I mean, spiritual counselors, people who do energy work to help you move through this and release it. Because most people are carrying the pain because they don't know how to heal it, how to release it. So what we do, we cover it up. We compensate by spinning and spinning religion, sex, alcohol, drugs, gossip, TV, and TV is a main conditioning. It programs people's mind. And in the book, I talk a lot about how the subconscious mind is conditioned. And you don't even realize it.
No, you don't. Well, a big part of, I think people have a tendency, they always want to put themselves on the cross. You know, and
yes.
Because the cross is a symbol of pain, suffering,
yes.
And death. So they always want to make themselves the Jesus. You know what I'm saying? They don't want to make themselves the revolutionary Jesus,
right.
Who went out to make change.
To make
they
change.
Want to make themselves the Jesus that has, you know, a thorn of crowns on their head and
suffering.
You know, and being stab wounds and bleeding and, you know, and being carried away on the cross. And, you know, that symbol is one that's constantly being perpetuated, especially among people of our culture. People of African origin, you know, the rap group of people,
mm-hmm.
They will wear the bling bling with the cross, the big cross and the Jesus on it. And I recommend that they, you know, research and find out what the Ankh represents.
Right.
You know, I don't have my Ankh on today, but I wear an Ankh, and I do have jewelry with an Ankh. As a matter of fact, I have, I like to wear scarabs because scarabs represent transformation. Scarabs
mm-hmm.
represent change.
Right.
And when people came to our culture and they saw us as an African people, they thought we were worshiping animals, worshiping a scarab, worshiping a baboon. When you go to temples in Egypt, you will see baboons in front of the temples because the baboon would get up in the morning and as the sun rises, make his salat. And welcome the relationship the baboon has with the universe.
Wow.
And not that we were worshiping baboons.
Right.
And like I said, the Ankh represents life. It is the symbol of
right.
the male and the female. And as I think we said in our first interview, that you can only continue life and have duality if you have the male and the female. So an Ankh is a better symbol that you wear. It doesn't represent any religiosity. It represents
right.
life. Because we have to have a continuance of life.
And what amazed me about the cross for something that's supposed to represent something so sacred and so good, all the negative rappers, you know, the drug dealers, the killers, the mob, they all wear the cross and these big Jesus heads.
Right. Well, I think I'm you know, not being a person who practiced Christianity as a child,
mm-hmm.
but to me, and talking to most Christians, I once had a good friend of mine, husband, who had been estranged from her for many, many years, and when he got a woman pregnant, he came back to his wife to recommit his relationship with his wife, and they joined a church in Virginia called the Rock Church, and he dialogue with me and told me I was going to hell because I didn't believe Jesus Christ was my Lord and Savior.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, you know, I don't know about you, but I have lived a life that is a lot more